Hello, I am Shamad, a student of IIM Trichy, PGP batch 2019-21. So today I'll talk about the economic divide between the two regions, that is the Northern India and Southern India. While the GDP numbers offer no respite, the World Bank cut its financial 20 GDP forecast for India, citing a severe cyclical slowdown. So the World Bank was only echoing the views of several agencies, brokerages and rating firms, including Moody's Investor Services. It is needless to say that the outlook for India's economy hasn't been gloomier in recent memory. However, to the south of the Vindhyas, it is a different story. From crowded high street shopping locations in Chennai to the packed pubs in Bengaluru to further south in Kochi's Lulu Mall, that is India's largest, with around 80,000 in footfall and daily turnover running into crores. It is business as usual and there are absolutely no signs for slowdown. So, how does one explain this stark divergence? First, let's sample some numbers. In August, bank credit to consumer durables shrunk by 13% from March to 5,484 crores, while credit card loans surged 10.5% to 97,500 crores, implying that the festival season demand could have pushed up card-based transactions. Interestingly, though rural distress, low agricultural income and sluggishness in employment generation due to a slowness in manufacturing have taken the blame for the current state of affairs, the southern parts of the country have remained largely unaffected. According to Nielsen data, in fast-moving consumer goods, that is the FMCG sales, the south logged a jump of 11 and 12% in rural and urban belts respectively, against a mere 2 and 8% in North India, though growth for both the regions eased from its 2018 highs. Now consider the installed electricity generation capacity, an indicator of industry utilization. It grew by 11% in the south against 4% in the north, while the eastern region witnessed a degrowth of 2.74%. That could be an obvious offshoot since the north lacks the southern regions in terms of the count of factories. The annual survey of industries data reveals that South India is ahead by a huge margin. Excluding the union territories, the five southern states have 90,513 factories, whereas the north has only a shade over 50,000. The east and west too are far behind. More factories come up in a particular region only if demand and consumer sentiment offer strong prospects. Higher installed electricity generation capacity in South India corroborates this. So, what explains the region's resilience? A low dependence on agricultural income may be the most obvious factor that insulates South India, as it mitigates the impact of monsoon vagaries on consumer spending to a large extent. However, there are other elements behind this deep divide. So let's have a look at the few important ones. First, loan disbursements. Growth in personal loan is a proxy for demand outlook and consumer sentiment. Data for 2017-18 shows that outstanding personal loans to the southern belt were 6.9 lakh crore, the highest among all regions. The same for the northern and western part of the country stood at approximately 3.3 lakh crore and 4.68 lakh crores respectively. With a 22.5% CAGR in personal loans over the last decade, South India is marginally behind the Western belt, but ahead of the Northern areas. In terms of another key metric, credit deposit ratio, or the sum lent for every 100 rupees in deposits received, the South is a clear leader. That is, that leads at 93.2%. Similarly, the region has approximately 39,600 bank branches. In fact, North India, with 25,800 branches, lags the South by a decade, while the Eastern Belt has only half as many branches as the South. Interestingly, the North-South divergence in credit flow is even wider for regional rural banks, RRBs, where the outstanding credit to the South is almost thrice of that in the North. The second one is new investments. Regional trends in gross fixed capital formation, a proxy for new investments, show the North woefully lacking the southern and western regions. Data for 2016 and 17, which is latest available, shows the average gross fixed capital formation for the southern and western regions were 17,676 crores and 23,560 crores respectively. At 7,683.5 crore, the North was way behind the West and South. This is a worrisome trend. since it underlines the highly muted investment sentiment in the vast northern belt of the country. Worse, this situation triggers a vicious cycle. Companies only commit fresh investments where demand forecast is robust. However, until fresh investments trickle in, no jobs will be created and there won't be any improvement in individual income, which in turn means low consumption driven demand. The overall bank credit growth reflects the skew in investments, with the West and South leading outstanding bank credit dispersals. Undoubtedly, bank credit is a huge enabler of demand. The third is income growth. The population weighted per capita income in the southern states, a metric of financial well-being, is way ahead of the north. According to a study conducted by T.V. Mohandas Pai, chairman of Manipal Group, the southern states grew at impressive 10 to 12.5% CAGR compared with north's 9 to 12% between 2011-12 and 2017-18. If this rate continues for another decade, the gap is set to widen and eventually the per capita income levels in the south could become double of that in the northern belt. This extrapolation takes into account the fact that the population growth rate in northern region is higher than the south. However, the relative affluence of the south is also attributed to the emergence of sunrise sectors and IT hubs, improving employment prospects and income levels of its educated youth. The fourth factor is the cities. Urban clusters create stronger consumption-led demand and higher growth. Moreover, urban agglomeration has undergone a dramatic shift in favor of the south. According to the 2011 census, 15 out of the 53 urban agglomerations with more than a million in population were in the south, while a century ago the pattern was in favor of the North India. A huge out-migration from Uttar Pradesh, West Bengal and Bihar to Kerala and Karnataka also highlights the emergence of the south as a major hub of employment, apart from explaining why these regions can better withstand the demand shocks. The fifth important point is remittances. Huge deposits from NRIs, non-resident Indians, too play an important role. Out of total remittances of $79 billion US in 2018, 19% went to Kerala, the highest recipient. The four southern states together accounted for half of the gross NRI receipts, which aid demand and sometimes conspicuous consumption as well. Further, the depreciation of the rupee accentuates the wealth effect. The sixth and most important point is ease of doing business. Finally, on the ease of doing business rankings, three southern states, namely Andhra Pradesh, Telangana and Karnataka, are among the top 10. To be sure, northern states such as Delhi, Rajasthan, Haryana and Punjab too feature in the top 10, but they are crippled by the lack of robust infrastructure ecosystem that can attract investments. Further, tilting the balance in favor of the southern states is the demographics. A higher percentage of working age population and better income levels make southern India less vulnerable to economic shocks. The northern and eastern regions, on the contrary, are home to a young population. Further, the near absence of adequate infrastructure is a barrier in attracting big companies and state-of-the-art education institutions. This deprives the youth of rewarding employment opportunities, forcing them to take up low-paying jobs, which in turn pushes the economics of these states into an endless, inescapable loop of weak consumption and growth. So what is the bottom line? Though a stark disparity in resources and facilities has created a sort of economic divide between the North and South, it also opens up a big opportunity for the country. Multinational companies find the southern states more attractive for investments, primarily due to two reasons: talent pool and infrastructure. So, what I would suggest is therefore the government should loosen its purse strings and stop attaching undue importance to fiscal deficit targets. It should quickly build quality infrastructure and educational facilities in the northern and eastern states to tap a vast and young talent pool that will soon enter the country's workforce. The Finance Commission can even consider a higher devolution of taxes to such states for a temporary phase to fund development. If the government does not take charge of the situation immediately and turn this potential demographic into reality, it will soon turn into a nightmare.